All right, let's bring in now Israeli MP Sharan Haskell, who's with me live in Jerusalem. Sharan, great to see you in person. Welcome to the show. I had to come all the way to Israel to meet you face to face.
Yeah, no, it's wonderful to meet you. And thank you so much for being so brave to come to Israel during these difficult times.
Of course, we stand in solidarity with this great nation. Now, I want to ask you, on this sacred day yesterday, the anniversary of October 7, we saw Israel come under attack in the north, south, and over Tel Aviv. Can you tell us how hostile this was?
Well, look, the last 2 weeks has been difficult. There's direct attacks from Iran, Yemen, from Syria, from Lebanon, and from Hamas in the south. I'll tell you, as a mother, it's been really difficult because, you know, yesterday you've experienced the rockets, the interception in the middle of Tel Aviv. You had to hide. How do you communicate that to children, to two-year-old? My two-year-old twin, my three-year-old, we have to run in the middle of the night into shelters. And I think that's the most difficult thing. I mean, we're tough. We're really tough people. We can endure that. But the effect that it has on our children is what really difficult for us personally.
And I knew that there were a constant barrage of rockets coming from Hezbollah into the north, but I had no idea the extent of it until I was here, because I keep talking about this app that you have on your phone, and it pings whenever there's an incoming missile. And all day long, it pings. The majority are from the north.
Yeah, all day, all night. The north has been under attack for the last year, and the international community has promised Israel a diplomatic solution. That's why we tied our hands. Towns were destroyed, cities were destroyed, people are evacuated from their home, tens of thousands of refugees, people were murdered, children were murdered by those rockets, and they send them every single day. And so enough is enough. Just 2 weeks ago, we said we have to operate in order to bring back the safety and the security to our northern border. And that's what it is right now.
Everyone just forgets the 12 Israeli Druze children who were killed on the soccer field. Why should families in Israel, you know, have to put up with this? They need to clearly eliminate the terror threat. Sharan, I want to ask you about Iran. Clearly, the Netanyahu government must be right now in discussions with the United States about how to respond to Iran. We're expecting that response in the next few days, probably. Initially, there was discussion, and I spoke with Naftali Bennett yesterday. He thought the strike should be on Iran's nuclear sites to stop its nuclear development program. But now we're hearing in the New York Times that it looks like it's going to be on military sites, if you can believe those reports. Mm-hmm. What do you think should happen, and what do you think will happen?
I think that this is a regional opportunity, not just a regional opportunity. This is an opportunity to make a safer world for all of us. Iran is the leading force of radical Islam. It's spreading its tentacles everywhere. You see what they're doing now in Iraq. They're trying to create a coup in Jordan. It's only a matter of time. Now, think about this regime with nuclear power. This is an opportunity for the international community to make sure that in 5-10 years the world is safer. And I believe we need to target those nuclear reactors that Iran has been building for years now. And we need to target their missiles warehouses and missiles factory. This will create a more stable Middle East and a safer world for all of us, for all of our children.
And are you and your political allies advocating that position with the current government?
Yes, absolutely. There's been many voices, including mine and my party members, to try and advocate for that. I think that, obviously, it needs to come in cooperation with the United States.
And there's a U.S. election at the moment, so you wouldn't have thought the Democrats would have the appetite for a war with Iran.
Absolutely, but they wouldn't have another opportunity like that. And as the Iranian leadership, they only call Israel the little devil. America is the big devil. America is their main target, and they will not have another opportunity like that.
Yeah. Look, I want to finish by asking you about UNRWA, the United Nations aid organization. As my viewers know all too well, Penny Wong has given $82 million. This is hard-earned taxpayer dollars, $82 million to Gaza since October 7 attacks on Israel. It's inexplicable. Millions of that has gone to UNRWA. This is an issue or a fight that you personally are involved in. What are you doing?
Well, right now we're passing a legislation that will disconnect the ministries, the defense ministry and the foreign ministry, from communicating with UNRWA. UNRWA is a compromised organization that was taken over by Hamas, by a terrorist organization. Through UNRWA, Hamas is controlling and indoctrinating the entire population of Gaza. That's how they recruit terrorists into their army of terror. And we have to dismantle that if we want a different future. Now, understanding that that's what needs to happen and knowing the actions of Penny Wong and the current government is heartbreaking, because just 2 days ago, Hamas had said that when Israel eliminated a senior commander, he was the head of the unions of teacher of UNRWA in Lebanon. Okay? It means that Penny Wong is paying the salaries of terrorists, of Hamas high commander activists on one hand, while it's sending condolences on the other. You can't have it both ways. You have to choose. Either you fight those radical Islamist voices, those terrorists who want to...
So you're saying Australia is funding terrorism through UNRWA?
Absolutely, and they know that.
All right, Sharon Haskell, it's been so wonderful meeting you in person and having you on the show here in Jerusalem. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.